So guys, we hear the term psychedelic revolution, and I want you to know that if you're in this room right now, you are on the forefront of that revolution. You are right at the front lines of it. And we are doing something that in the south of the United States is not being done. I can tell you that as an undergraduate researcher myself, we come into a lot of confrontation when we try to bring these topics back into the mainstream. And just by us gathering here today and empowering the voices that have come from across the country, we're really taking a step forward and trying to give our community a place to have it in, within universities once again. That was stripped from us in the 1960s, and it doesn't have to be like that way any longer. So we really appreciate you guys being here. We're going to get the panel started, and yeah, we hope you guys enjoy. Thanks.
Grand rising, everyone. I'm not going to cry in these streets, but if you see me crying, just know it's out of joy. Obviously, when we first started thinking about bringing Tamerrian to Miami, I definitely thought it was going to be very small, but to see so many people here today and so many great speakers and just us growing every year really gives me so much passionate joy to continue. So thank you so much for being here so early in the rising. It is with great honor that I pass the mic over to Ramasu. He is going to introduce himself, so I'm not going to take his thunder. But I just want to say that if you don't know who Baba Kilindi Iyi is, I mean, hopefully if you're at this conference, you do. But if not, please do look him up and share his message. Pass his videos around. Let's keep the legacy alive. Because the reality is that here in these academic settings that we are currently in, they're not talking about him. They're not talking about us. And all the research that's being done does not include us. So we need to be here today. Our voices matter, and I'm so grateful to share space with you all. Peace.
Peace and greetings, everyone. I am at Kura Ramasu Iyi, son of Ahati Kilindi Iyi. It's an honor to be here. It's an honor to see these conferences go on and see my father's work continue, because this was a tough road. A lot of people didn't respect, you know, us in these fields. You know, it seemed like everybody was trying to talk about this but us. And Baba said, you know, we all have a stake in this thing. We all have to put our foot out there, put ourselves out there, let them know that this is for everybody. The Tamerrian Institute is basically a martial arts school. If people don't know, my father was a martial artist, and he was a real martial artist. He was the real deal. And in martial arts, he was searching for the mysteries. And that's when he came upon learning that in martial arts has a psychedelic component. That's what started this whole thing, was martial arts. You know, that's what started him into psychedelics. A lot of people don't realize that psychedelics is in martial arts. That's what it is. That's where martial arts comes from. It comes out of the mysteries of other realms. And this is, like I said, I'm overwhelmed just to see my father's work continue. Just, you know, seeing this go on is, you know, such a beautiful thing. You know, I'm absolutely honored that that you all came out, especially, you know, from far away. You know, we came all the way from Detroit.
Ashe. All right, so thank you. You may have a seat. Thank you, sir. So we are going to now introduce, for the MCs for the day, we are going to be Entheoplex. So this will be my last introduction. But I did want to be the one to introduce our keynote speaker today. Baba Moudou, he is like heaven on earth with the information that he has. And I just really honor the fact that he's here to share his wisdom. Ashe, thank you for your time. So he's going to come and speak, and I know that we had him on for an hour, but since we got a little delayed, it'll be about 30 minutes, and then after this, we'll have our Divine Feminine panel. So with that, I now yield to Baba Moudou to start the day off.
First off, my name is Baba Moudou Baqui. I am a proud member of the Tamerrian family and an honored student of Kilindi Iyi. A little bit about how I got started. I began this journey, well, I first met Kilindi at the age of, 19 or 20, because I was organizing an event that was annually called the Self-Determination Conference. It was a gathering of leaders, thinkers, activists, economists, you name it. And we were determined to teach the common people self-determination love. And so in that pursuit, of course, someone told me to invite this gentleman named Kilindi. When I met him, of course, if anybody who's been around will know, he's very, very quiet. He was always very quiet, stoic individual. So being young, I was equally intimidated, but we had a few brief words. And I didn't realize that this would be the beginning of a long relationship. Just a little bit about me, I was raised in an activist household. I was raised studying with Kilindi, just to understand the science of self-defense and community organizing. So that's when me and my brother Greg, we officially joined Tamerrian Institute. It's important I'm giving this context because most of the world, they see and regard Kilindi from his work as an expert on the mushrooms or sacred plant medicine. But he was a man of many hats. For one, many people don't know that he was a stonemason. He knew how to work stones. He was also a prolific gardener as well. He also helped found two independent schools. A lot of people don't know that as well. He was very much into the academics. So he was a very, very multifaceted individual. More than anything, he was a family man. So he loved and took care of his family. Why are we saying this? Because right now, in the context of psychedelic science and psychedelic world, we talk about knowledge of these plant medicines, but we don't talk about knowledge of these plant medicines and what functionality looks like. In other words, too many people have skewed, and it's fine, because the discussion skews toward the most enjoyable aspect of these plants, which is the inebriation, the getting high, the getting buzzed. But bigger than that is getting functional and understanding the why behind the what. Why was this a key tool for Kilindi in his exploration of consciousness and his push for freedom? The why behind the what. And the why essentially was his understanding of ancient history, contemporary history, and future considerations. When I met with Kilindi, one of the first things he began to tell me is that our tradition, a lot of things were taught from mouth to ear. So a lot of things that were taught to me were not something you'll find on YouTube, and that's the traditional African way from teacher to student from mouth to ear. A lot of which I couldn't even cover in enough time that the time we have allotted. But essentially, he began to teach me about ancient historical timelines. In particular, the original timeline that existed before the what we call Younger Dryas era. What people didn't understand and what he taught me was that humanity's expression as a sophisticated society happened several times previous to this. And not only did it happen several times previous to this, there's ample records of this. Whether we talk about the Enuma Elish, the Babylonian creation story, or we talk about the Medo-Netra, which talks about the creation of the planet. So in these studies, what we began to do, what he had me do is compare all of these ancient pre-early young Dryas creation stories, and what you'll find is a parallel. And some of these parallels are amazing. We're talking about parallels with China, Asia, South America, North America, Europe. All of them talking about key aspects. The biggest aspect they talk about was the gods and our origins of species. Now, this is outside our conventional thinking because most of us, unfortunately, well, not unfortunately, but we haven't been given a, let's just say, a smorgasbord of understanding spiritual approaches. So most of us in this room have been Christianized. So if I tell you about Nephilim and God, it may sound preposterous, but then we've also been taught to consider some of the things of the Bible, like men being swallowed by whales, as feasible. Well, I'm here to tell you that all of these things are feasible, But this ancient timeline suggested that as human beings, we had origins that existed beyond this planet and before what we know. And that we were seeded by these super hyper intelligent beings. And in this seeding, as alluding to the Adam and Eve story, these deities, these entities, were so, they worshiped us, but at the same time, they caged us into what we call the Garden of Eden, as we know that story. According to the ancients, there was an interdimensional debate. Being seeds of the divine, we were locked into this garden, but one half of this so-called debate said, how could you make them divine but also lock them up? The other half says, shut your mouth, they're divine and they're going to be my personal pets. So this is the beginning and the part of the Enuming Leash that was brought and put into the Bible when they talk about Adam and Eve. But many of these creation myths, they speak toward the time in which we were seeded with this ancient dyadic blood. And in an attempt to keep us ignorant, there were forces that kept us ignorant, but there are also forces that decided to give us knowledge. Now, I'm going to fast forward with this story, but the reason I'm talking about it is because this leads directly to what we're doing now. In this story, there was a great need for these powers to be to keep humanity as we know it ignorant and dependent. And then there was another force that was very interested in informing humanity. And these were known as the early gods. And in the Bible, they talk about angels sleeping with the daughters of men. Now, I'm moving fast because this is, like I said, it's probably an hour and a half, 2 hours, and I'm condensing it. But in this work, what happened was that the gods began to share some of their technologies with the human beings. So when you look at the historical record, you'll see early Homo erectus rapidly advancing at a certain point, and it can't be accounted for. Now, all the ancient historical records through every culture on the planet Earth says this came from direct intercession with other beings. Now, according to these records, these other beings, once again, had a great debate. Some wanted to control us. Some wanted to inform us of our greater will. But in this tug of war, they said they were hybrid human beings created. Now, this sounds a little wild, but even if you look at the historical record, it's well documented. All of us have heard of the I Ching or the I Ching. Many of us have never heard of the I Ching. The I Ching is the book of the Asian creation of their society. And in the creation of society, the first 10 dynasties of Chinese civilizations were considered hybrid dragon humans. This is why you find the dragon so celebrated in Asian culture. But if we move further and we look into the Hindu culture, we'll see the story between the Pandavas, the war of the Pandavas and Krishna. And once again, an allusion to the great serpent. We move further, we talk about Kemet, we talk about Maya, which the founding member of the Mayan civilization was a serpent. We talk about Kemet, we talk about the Dogo that interacted with the Nomo, who are considered the wise serpents. Why am I saying this? It's because there's ample evidence, and here we're in the medical college, we know that the most primitive part of the human brain is called the what? Can somebody help me? The reptilian brain. So it's well established in biological science that there was a very ancient admixture of what makes us human. Now, according to these ancients, these guys that laid with the daughters of men, and this is our great teacher, these daughters that lay with these angels, or these beings that lay with the daughters of men, laced technology, left technology behind, like brickwork, like sewing, like understanding of agriculture and the human body. One of the other things that was alluded to in these ancient records that these guys left behind tools for us, and they were called the seven sacred plants, one of which is cannabis, one of which is considered the sacred mushroom. The ancients say that these things were left behind as sort of a mnemonic device to help us reach our way back to our needed divinity. I know it sounds weird, but this was similar to a time capsule that was left behind that was designed to help this fledgling human species get back to dyadic status. And this is some of the teachings of my teacher, my grandmaster, Ahati Kilindi, Why was this important? Because one of the things that he would always impress is that as human species, we've been oppressed and dumbed down to an extent that we have no knowledge of who we are. To an extent that we're suffering needlessly through issues of famine, disease, warfare, and ignorance. Why? Part of what I was taught by Kilindi is that there are active energies, forces that depend on our ignorance as a human species, that depend on us being basically bathing apes, as we like to call ourselves these days. But these technologies left behind by our potential spiritual allies were designed to help refine us. So the question is now, in 2023, what is the expression of psychedelic science? Is it higher than just getting high, or is it about evolving to the gods? Now, I'm sorry about the graininess of this picture, but I had to show you this. This is a very special occasion I had with Baba Kilindi when we went and visited the Gombe people of Ghana. And when we went over there, we were greeted by the war priest, and they wanted to know what our school taught and how we taught it. So the first thing they asked us to do was to dance. Similar to an experience we had a few weeks ago, they said, can you do this? And I said, that's our school dance. Immediately, once we started doing the dance, they gave Kilindi a wreath, a sacred acacia leaf wreath. At that point, these war priests, this gentleman right here, who's the head war priest of the God, began to visit Baba every day that we were there, to the point in which our host began to get jealous. Our host is getting whispered to right there. And the reason that he was upset was because apparently Kilindi knew more about the ancient history and more about the ancient plant technology and more about ancient African culture than this gentleman over here, who was born and raised in Ghana as a god to Ghana. So at that point, he was being initiated, he was being seated as a warrior priest, as the maintainer of the sacred balance between energies in the village. And at that point, this is when the head priest is telling him, sorry, chief, you're going to have to share this with Kilindi. And so here's them giving a blood sacrifice to Kalindi's feet, a very ancient tradition. So before he passed, he was considered a war chief of the god, a priest war chief of the god. Now, why am I saying this? After we did this, they took us on a procession amongst their sacred shrines. Now, only a few people are allowed to see these shrines. Fortunately enough, we were invited to these shrines. Unfortunately, I wasn't able to, and I'm not going to provide the picture because it's a very sacred picture. But at the very last shrine, when we walk into it, they exclude everybody out but a few people. When they bring the shrine out, for those of us who don't know African culture, these sacred shrines represent the most sacred aspects of the divine. And they give libations and ablutions to it to strengthen the spiritual power of the village. The highest shrine they had, in the center of it, was the mushroom. This was the secret of the ages. Why? Well, who were the God Gombe? The God Gombe were the chief opponents of the Ashanti. They were the chief opponents of the slave trade. They knew from this ancient spirit plant technology that they were fighting a galactic war that we fight it today. And this is part of the teachings that Kilindi shared with me. Our symbol at Tamerrian Institute is laden with symbols that indicate this tug of war between forces and energy and why the sacred plant is important. Per Ansar is the theme of our school, House of Life. Before this age, they were what you call Per Ansar dotted around the globe. Per Ansars were everywhere, houses of life. And what they taught was what we call earth science, or the science of divinity. So in our symbol, we represent the Ka and the Ba, those aspects of the spirit, those two aspects of the spirit. The over spirit, the God, the overlord, and the inner lord, the personal spirit, the Ka and the Ba. Here we represent the jet column, which represents the spinal column. It represents more than having an upright posture. It represents more than having a good moral code. What it represents was the excitation of this kundalini, which we call the uraeus, which will travel up the jet and illuminate what we call the cave of Brahma. Through this sacred process, you would reach illumination and you would become the Godhead. You would be the master of both the crook and the flare. The crook is there to maintain your more animalistic nature. The flare is there to maintain your spiritual Godhead so that you don't get out of control. Was activating the human spirit toward God here. As he was taught to me, the gods have abandoned us. It's equivalent to having you being the inheritor of a divine kingdom. Your parents have moved on, they've passed. Left behind are two worn uncles. One uncle is a worn drunkard that loves everything of the planet Earth, everything of the material world, everything of the sensual realm. The other uncle is an extreme religiosus, judgmental individual who believes in purity and all of that. Both of them know of your divine inheritance. Both of them have interest in controlling your divine inheritance. Both of them are vying to control your mindset. This, as expressed through the Enuma Elish, which was the ancient Babylonian story, indicated that the human spirit is bound between two energies, materialism and spiritualism. The ancient teachings used to say it was a war between Satan and Lucifer. In other words, Satan, that which dwells on the planet Earth and deals with those things of the corporal material realm, versus Lucifer, the being of light, the great deceiver, that which appears well-meaning. Understanding that just as dangerous as a materialistic existence can be is a Luciferic existence in which you become intoxicated on notions of spirituality to the point that you become judgmental, to the point where you justify the subjugation of humans based on spiritual values, to the point where you become of no use to the human condition. And this is one of the issues that right now is being faced in the psychedelic community. There's a lot of Luciferic energy floating around. There's a lot of etheric floating around. Peace and love, but no attendance to child abuse and poverty and hunger, injustice. It's enough tuning out of reality as we know it to make us Luciferic. In other words, blinded by the light. The other aspect that's affecting our world is the satanic energy. Those individuals are in it strictly for the what? The bad. Right? Now, can any of us say we're not guilty of any of these notions influencing us? No. The goal of us is to be vigilant of these forces that pull us one way or the other, so that we don't become Luciferic beings and we don't look up like our unfortunate situation in Guyana where people drink the Kool-Aid. But at the other hand, we don't end up, you know, just a local hustler, hustling the bag. Our road is the middle road. We are to show a better expression of humanity. We are to show humans an expression of divine rootedness with abundance. And to the extent that we can show that is to the extent that this movement will grow, to the extent that we get intoxicated by this Luciferic or satanic energy is to the extent that this movement will short circuit. To the extent that we're not aware of these forces and how they impact this world of psychedelics is to the extent that we're going to find ourselves in trouble. This is spiritual work that we're involved in. I don't even know what my time is, but this is serious Sigi Tolo. This is something that's very special to our ancestors. I'm skipping around. Special to humanity. This is the central sun of the universe. This speaks toward a greater destiny of humanity. Now, we've been taught about the sun. But we never were taught that the sun goes around another sun. And this sun has a precession just like our sun has a precession. We're taught a static notion of reality that's like last year is just like this year. No, we're constantly evolving. The earth is constantly evolving. Where we are in this universe is constantly evolving. And so this comeuppance of this psychedelic energy in 2023 is in alignment with cosmological changes that's going on. It's in alignment with the shifting of the magnetic poles, which are now over Russia now. It's in alignment with the increase in sunspots. It's in alignment with a lot of cosmological things. So as we as this energy comes up, it's going to be more imperative that we understand these forces that's going to try to influence us. I've telling you before, this has happened 3 or 4 times in which humanity has reached the peak of technological enlightenment and spiritual enlightenment. If you want to find a contemporary story, read about the Tower of Babel. Okay? This is not the first time that humans have tapped into that aspect of divinity and been so close to doing something great. Now, all the records say the gods have destroyed us once we tried, but anyway, this is the Enuma Elish. This is a representation of the Younger Dryas incident. This is the first incident that wiped out life as we know it on the planet Earth. This is when we talk about the Atlanteans, when we talk about those individuals that could build pyramids through levitation and such. Once that occurred, once again, as the records say, those sons and daughters of the gods came back to Earth and seeded us with technology. From that point, the planet Earth began to redesign itself, as we know the story of how the rocky Earth's crust became broken up through the presence of mycelium and mushrooms. That broken soil became the basis for soil, also early grasses, birds, and such. So humanity had a reset. You see the early Homo erectus through the stone ape theory in which they would ingest these sacred mushrooms to develop frontal lobe reasoning, which many speculate was the gap between us and those primates. But the ancestors, such as Emperor Wu, founder of the Xi dynasty, says differently. This is a nice picture of him, but all accounts of him say that he had a tail and scales, and that he was half serpent. I know it sounds crazy. Before him, all his ancestors were said they were serpents, straight up. Why is he important? Because he was the only other person outside the Bible. No, there were 4 other people that chronicled the great flood that Noah talked about. He was created with getting rid of the flood waters. Don't ask me how. But this is why he was the founder of the Xi dynasty on the Yellow River region of China. For some mysterious way, he was able to get rid of the flood waters, and by all accounts written, he was half reptilian. And he left the China civilization with aspects of how to use rice, how to weave, how to write, how to build structures, the science of the bamboo plant, the science of the constellations. I can't make it up. This is mycelium, this is the myelin sheath. I'm just, like I say, hopping around again because this is a direct connection to how the inner birth represents the universe. Mycelium, as we know, connects the plant world of as we know it, is the internet of nature. We also have a mycelium network in our body called the myelin sheath, which coats both aspects of the brain, which allows us to communicate with both hemispheres of the brain, just to show us how we have fungus in us as well. Democratic Republic of Congo, y'all all are familiar why that's important. This was the earliest expression of humans as we know. From there, we know that the sacred use of mushrooms created high civilization in Africa, and this spread across the globe. In other words, this was a human cultural expression. That's why you can always say we are all African. That's why I say everything I do is African-centered. Like, what does that mean? It's human-centered. Simple as that. I used to teach at an African-centered school, so critics will come and say, well, that's just racist. I say, well, did all humans come from Africa? Yeah. So what's your point? I guess the point in which you divide humans becomes the racism, right?
Yeah.
Okay. India, ample representation of mushroom. We have Indra, we have Krishna, we have all of these individuals who reach enlightenment through the use of the mushrooms, the Eleusinian mysteries. A lot of this we know already, but it's just still good to review. This is the earlier glyph of the Adam and Eve. This is the earliest stone glyph of Jesus, the earliest fresco, I think, in Italy of Jesus. Okay, this is Leto Guai. This is one of the early founders of Japan, of Japanese culture, who was also spoken of having extraterrestrial understandings and the founder of martial arts. A lot of people don't know that. So this brother right here was known to come on the monsoons from Kenya and thought to have brought the science of martial arts to China and Japan, the Japan first to China. This is a modern representation of psychedelic distribution throughout the world. And we know that this is bullshit, right?
Yeah,
we know that. And this is what spurred Baba Kilindi to start doing on-the-ground research. And I was blessed to be able to accompany him in several regions in Africa. And when you ask them about sacred plant medicine, they laugh at you because it's on every corner. Every corner. It's no big deal because in Africa you tap into the spirit and it's not a commodity. So you can't buy it off. They're not going to allow you to make a documentary on it. They're not going to let you bring your tour bus in. They're not going to let you build an integration center in the middle of their village. No, because to them, this is a function of reality. Their ability to transcend the physical world is just like taking a shower. So when you go to Africa and you go looking for the woo-woo, they look at you like woo-woo because it's not woo-woo to them. This is everyday reality. You know, this is a sidereal calendar, a comedic sidereal calendar. Sidereal calendar speaks once again, alludes to that ancient history that I speak to. I would suggest that anybody go look at sidereal calendars, and just about every culture has a sidereal calendar. Sidereal calendar measures time a little differently. It measures in an increments of 25,000 year blocks. So this will help you understand just where we are in this very beautiful saga that we call human earth development. And it's interesting because this comes out of the a Dogo group. But you see the cultural linkage. These things are concurrent throughout the world. And this is, as you say, a work of Dogo spiritual master. The Dogo, who used acacia extensively, had very good knowledge of how our procession was going. And through the use of acacia, they were able to see the procession of our future 25,000 years in advance. So when you see the Dogo, and they're wearing a mask. The mask is made out of acacia. Everything they use, their tools are made of acacia. The food, some of the drink they use to tap in is acacia. The crown of thorns that Jesus used was acacia. The cross that Jesus was buried on, acacia. This is why I titled this The Sprig of Hierarchy, because those high-ranking masons know what the value of the acacia plant is. And they'll tell you that when Hiram Abiff, who knew the master, who's the master builder, who knew the secret of the cornerstone, was hit in the head, buried in a shallow grave, after he was buried, a sprig came up from his grave, and that sprig was the acacia plant. And so in Masonic lore, you can't cut the acacia plant with anything but the golden sickle, because it is the secret of the master mason. They put it out there for those who have eyes to see. This is the swastika before it was co-opted by German racism. The swastika is a symbol that was used throughout history. But it was also used as a symbol to represent the procession of man through these different ages. And this is why Hitler was so fond of it, because to him it represented the changing of an age. To him it represented the entrance of the Kali Yuga, the entrance of the age of warfare and destruction. And this is why concepts such as Blitzkrieg and things were appealing to him. This is why he made sure that his entire army stayed high on barbiturates. People don't understand why the German fighting machine was such, because he intermingled metaphysics and plant medicine. This is why the SS would march for days without stopping. He understood if he used his metaphysics and his sacred plant medicine, he applied his satanic power. Understand? His satanic and luciferic power. Not to give any energy to that. But after the Kali Yuga, this is supposedly where we're entering right about now. This is the Silver Age, the Age of Enlightenment. In case you don't know, good people, this is the most peaceful time in human history. So don't let anybody lie to you that, oh Lord, this is the most peaceful time. Dig that. This is the most peaceful time in human history. And every year it becomes more peaceful. So part of the sorcery is to get us to constantly meditate on what's bad. And part of what I get people to do is say, I want you to imagine how many people got the level we're looking for today. I want you to imagine how many people learned that they were having a child today. I want you to imagine how many people entered their first home today. How many people graduated, had birthdays, met the love of their life. See, we have to begin to meditate on this because they get us to meditate on so many things that are detracting from our spirit. But the truth of the matter is things are changing and the work is being done. And part of our role is to help the work that's being done. Why? Because humanity is immature. COVID sent us into a tailspin. It's the first time human beings had to sit with their own thoughts. And so now there's massive spiritual crisis because people are so used to playing roles. You know, you put your suit and tie on, say, hi, Bill, how's the coffee this morning? You know, you can play the game and you go to the club. You can always play these roles. But now we're in our own skin, and humans don't know how to live in their own skin. This is the role of psychedelic science. We're going to push individuals to evolution, a new way of living, a balance between that satanic and Lucifer force that taps into our divinity. It utilizes the best of our material science and the best of our spiritual science to create a better life. So yes, when you go on these high-dose journeys, the expectation is to bring back disruptive technology. Not just to say, oh, this shit was high, live, and oh, I had a orgy for 8 hours. Oh, hell no. That's great. Your job is to push this envelope. Our job is to push this envelope. Disruptive technologies. It doesn't have to be a solar panel. It can be a disruptive social technology. It could be a new way to relate. It could be a new way to form business, new way to build community. This is our role. And so it's so important that we have an understanding of this so that we don't get sidetracked. I know I'm running out of time. This is a representation of the Mayan calendar, which represented the great seismic shift that we're going through. And finally, this is the erase. This is the actual work that we're about. We're about stimulating our kundalini, our base center at the base of our spine. Increasing the flow of our cerebral spinal fluid, the CSF. This is the fluid that lines our spine. Increasing it to the aspect in which you can quench the thirst of this cobra. And I'm getting high metaphysical. I'm trying to squeeze it in really quick. But the idea of high meditation is to stimulate your kundalini, to get it to reach up, while at the same time drawing down your cerebral spinal fluid to quench the thirst of this cobra. This eventually will move up your spinal cord through your cable ground, enlightenment. This is what it meant by enlightenment. And this is what we're about, enlightenment. This is why when you take high-dose mushrooms, you find your hips gyrating, because the snake is awakened. And through understanding breaths, bond the sacred locks, postures, and the understanding of the cerebral spinal fluid, how you can connect these centers is the science that we're looking for. This cerebral spinal fluid controls every aspect of your biological being, everything from your emotions to your digestion to your immune system. Scientists are starting to realize that through this brain science, through what we call the cave of Brahma, waking reality itself can be manifested. And I wish we had more time, but as we go, connecting directly to the vagus nerve, which connects to your gut, which communicates with your microbiome, which is your inner universe, that links in with your cerebral spinal, which goes back and forth to communicate with that cave of Brahma. So when we talk about the Godhead, we talk about populating our gut to an aspect in which we have healthy bacteria. We talk about understanding posture and breath, which can cause the cerebral spinal fluid to flow freely. And then we call tapping into higher consciousness. So when we eat mushrooms and other substances, it's not our brain up here. It's our enteric brain that's filling it. It's our gut brain. And then it communicates anyway. I wish I had more time. So thank y'all very much. I like to think that the science can be investigated and respected. It's very rare. And anybody who lends his work knows how rare. Matter of fact, I challenge you to think of another academic psychedelic conference with this type of representation. You won't find it. So this is a record-breaking conference, and I believe in the future it's going to create record-breaking, new, innovative insights. So salute to the University of Miami.